Our first panel this afternoon, or this morning, is titled Best Practices, where our three specialists will provide some tips to you for how to run an athletic communications office in the 21st century. My name is Dennis O'Donnell. I'm the Director of Athletic Communications at the University of Rochester. Before I introduce the panelists, we have a brief presentation from one of EAST-COMM's major sponsors. The sponsors allow the board to organize workshops like these to assist you in professional growth. Our guest this morning is Leslie Basler, the Director of Product for Presto Sports. Leslie, the Zoom floor is all yours.
Thanks, Dennis. So I will pull my screen up really quick, and I just want to share with you all some big initiatives that we're working on at Presto right now that are really going to simplify the processes for you guys on a daily basis, especially when it comes to events. So it's moved over. So one of the big things that we're working on right now is really simplifying the workflow between our different platforms. So when it comes to streaming, when it comes to web, and specifically for this, our new infographics platform, which is ScoreShots, we acquired about a year ago. So right now, this is for those of you who are website clients, you would have this ability to, when you purchase a ScoreShots package, to actually produce graphics that are powered by the stats that you're putting in. So whatever stats platform you're using, as long as you're sending those to your Presto website, you could just come in here, click add infographic, and then you can see the ones here that actually are supported by the integration with this little asterisk. So since I have a game in progress, I'll just select in game. You can leave this blank and it will pull up all of them. You can also, if you wanted to use a background image in these graphics from your website, you can use that, just select image field to bring in that background image. So you can see when I come over here, it automatically pulls in the sport where I was. It pulls in the category I selected. So if I did get in here and wanted to change the category or select a different one, I can do that. It also right now, it marks that it's only showing you the ones that are supported by the Presto integration. Now, if you have that ScoreShots package, which is required to use this functionality, you could actually disable this and see all of the templates that are available to you. And then you would still be able to see which ones are supported by that web integration. So now let's get down to what do I actually mean by the web integration. So what this is gonna do for this template in particular, because I've picked in-game, if I go here and I select this template, you can see it's automatically pulling in the score to my event. If I had the background image, it would pull that in as well. So you can do that with obviously multiple of these different templates, and we have the different options available. So game preview, post game, player performance, essentially any of the stats that are involved in the event that you have already uploaded to that event, you would be able to produce these. You could even do it just for post-game. If you were just uploading a post-game box score or something like that, you would still be able to produce these graphics with that ScoreShots package. Additionally, what we're working on right now is also a schedule integration. So if you have your schedule entered into the CMS, if you have your roster entered into the CMS, you would be able to produce graphics automatically without having to retype your schedule into ScoreShots or retype your roster into ScoreShots. Those things would be pulled automatically in if you're going in through the Presto CMS. So that's really one of the initiatives I wanted to show you all that we're working on. And like I said, to try to simplify that process. The other one is around our streaming platform. So I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with our embeddable player yet, but we're changing and going away from our portal platform right now and actually giving you a more modern feel, which is this embeddable player with the card look and feel on it. So this is actually the player itself. And then this is where you could just embed the player on a website. So this is actually available to any of our streaming clients, regardless of what website you have. Does not matter what website provider. We provide an embed code that you can just drop it into your site. So this is an example on one of our current theme sites of what it would actually look like just embedded on the page. And you could actually embed it really anywhere on a page. And then as far as management of the embeddable player, you would still set up your events right now through the legacy CMS, but you can actually do some customization yourself by coming into this tool. And you can even generate your own code. So you can select which tab you would want it to default to. You can select, you know, the different sport. If you wanted a different embeddable player per sport page, you would actually be able to set that up. So it only shows that sports events. And then we have some different categories that we're actually building out as well, and that you can actually create yourself also. So when you're managing cards, you can set up custom categories. So let's say you had something like a coach's show or something specific that you wanted to categorize, a tournament, let's say that you wanted to categorize specifically for events, you could actually do that as well. So that's just a couple of things I wanted to show you guys that we're working on, and I'll turn it back over to Dennis.
Thank you, Leslie. We'll have time for Q&As at the end of the panel. When you get a chance, please put your questions into the chat. Let's meet the panelists who you'll be listening to this morning. Our first speaker will discuss creative uses for video streaming beyond the broadcasting of home athletic events. Andrew Capitelli is the manager of athletic communications at St. Joseph's College on Long Island. St. Joseph's is a member of the Skyline Conference. He arrived at St. Joseph's in 2015 after working for 18 months as the SID at the Borough of Manhattan Community College. Before that, he was an intern in the athletic communications office at SUNY Old Westbury. Andrew earned his master's in sport management at Adelphi University and worked as an assistant in athletic communications. Once the event is over, you have to assemble a recap, game story, or whatever you wish to call it. Our second speaker will provide some guidelines for a variety of sports. Andrea James is finishing her 19th year in the business. She is the Associate Director of Athletic Communications at Carnegie Mellon University, a member of the University Athletic Association. She played softball at West Virginia Wesleyan University, then worked as a graduate assistant in that office while pursuing her MBA. She spent 1 year as an assistant at Allegheny College, then joined the CMU office in 2005. She helped former ECAC CIDA president Mark Fisher host this workshop in Pittsburgh in 2012. Hosting events on the same day, sometimes in the same time block, boy, isn't that fun, is one of the biggest challenges that you will face. How do you get through it? Our third presenter will tell you that. Nate Smith is the director of athletic communications at Alfred University, a member of the Empire 8 Conference. Among his varied duties are his work as a board member for Saxon Nation, a primary fundraising arm for the Athletic University Athletic Department. Nate started on his path as a journalism student at Buffalo State College, where he worked in the Sports Information Office. He was an assistant at Rochester Institute of Technology and at Skidmore College before taking his current role in 2019. Andrew, you're up.
Right. How's it going, everyone? Andrew Capitelli, Manager of Athletic Communications, St. Joseph's College. I'm just going to share my screen quickly. All right. So, a bit about me again, just actually, I mean, Dennis kind of took care of it, but there you go. Again, just to reiterate. So what I'm going to talk to you guys about today is how video can be used to help promote your athletic programs. I'm sure all at least familiar somewhat with video due to the regularity of live streaming contests. There are many other uses for video in athletic communications. Graphics and text are great and have their uses, but video is more intimate and can feature our student athletes and programs in more human lights. Furthermore, social media is very accommodating to video content, Twitter and Instagram in particular. Platforms we all use have been tailored in recent years for video pieces. In 2021, it's important for our departments to stay relevant on social, and video is captivating. For those that haven't taken the dive into video, it's really not that hard. You could always find equipment that fits your budgetary requirements. All right. The growth of video-specific platforms like Twitch and YouTube and social media platforms have had an enormous impact on the internet as a whole. They've given us great opportunities to promote our programs in-house with great effect. This is especially advantageous for small schools that struggle to generate local and regional interest via traditional media platforms like print, web, and TV. Before taking the plunge into video promotion, it's important to take stock and make a plan. Get an idea of what's at your disposal on campus and in your department. Do you have a tight budget? Are you well staffed? Are the academic programs and or students on campus that contribute to your video production, et cetera? Observe industry trends. Go see what others in athletic communications are doing. Look at bigger schools and schools more your size. Compare engagement and gather ideas. Another tip would be to identify your goals. What are you looking to get out of video promotion? Tailor your goals to department, program, and campus needs. Not every school is Ohio State, and that's okay. At SJC, we get essentially no media exposure due to nearly a dozen pro sports teams and seemingly countless college and high school sports programs to contend with in the New York Metro. It's up to us to promote our program and its student athletes to the best of our means. And finally, it's important to get familiar with video editing software. I'll come back to this later, but there are programs for every skill level. All right, so I'm going to give a few examples of what kind of video content I'm talking about. The first would be a season preview video. What I'm about to show right now, by the way, we all do it. I do it currently at SJC. I'm going to show examples as well. But the season preview video, essentially a substitute for season preview articles, which most of us already produce and don't typically get a lot of reads. These videos offer more exposure and higher engagement because they are easily postable to social media. At SJC, we attend and record a practice session, interview coach and a handful of student athletes, and then cut and edit the footage into 3-4 minute video. I'm just gonna show a quick little bit. I'll bounce around a little bit because I know we're probably pressed for time a bit. So I'm just gonna kind of bounce around just to get a feel of what we do here at SJC with a season preview video.
Preseason's been going pretty good. We have like the same group of boys still playing that we had last year, minus our center. Libero situation's a little different, but I mean, we still have the talent to compete. We have a pretty tough non-conference schedule, but like with the guys we have going out there, I'm pretty sure we'll be able to put up a good record and definitely give every team a good run for their money.
Well, this is our first year that we're going to have players who played all 4 years. So the senior class is our strength and they'll all start this year. And hitting as a freshman last year.
As you can see, it's basically just footage of the practice that I attended, and behind it is audio from the coach and the players. All right. So next one, spotlight graphics. At SJC, we do weekly student-athlete spotlight graphics for our social media pages. They get good engagement, but we like to keep it fresh, so we use the same concept and made some into videos. The videos offer a greater sense of vulnerability and allow our audience to get to know the student athletes even better. So that's an example right there on the screen of the just static graphics we post to social media. And this is an example of what we post.
My name is David Slager. I'm on the men's volleyball team. My nickname is Slocks. Practical Jokers. 10 years, I will be in my career job. I'll be married, probably have a couple kids, playing beach volleyball, still on the island. Cool Blue. C.S. Lewis, it is. Faith is taking the next step when you don't see the full staircase.
So that's those are our season preview videos. I'm sorry, that's our spotlight videos. As you can see, it's just like a different look. And common theme with these videos that I'm going to talk about is that they're easily digestible and really well tailored to social media. So like a video like that was posted just using the regular video capabilities with Instagram. There's also IGTV. I'll come back to that later, actually with the next video, which is going to be weekly highlight packages. So basically these are, I'm sure some of you guys already do this, short video packages published to social media are a good way to highlight team and individual successes. Since some audiences are long distances from campus, these are also good ways to show glimpses of facilities and capture game atmosphere. Size of staff and resources available to you will determine how often these are edited and published. At SJC, it was something we did on a Monday or a Tuesday, recapping home victories from the week prior, so it was manageable. I don't know if I mentioned, we have two full-time SIDs at SJC. We have 20 varsity athletic programs. So we do have the capability to take on some of these additional video. So this is an example of something, we call it a SJC rewind. And this is just a little tip. You guys get the point with that. So again, that was, I don't remember if this was just the regular video on Instagram, but I mentioned the IGTV. That kind of comes into greater effect here with my next example. Basically, IGTV allows you to post long form videos to Instagram. I'll get to that in a minute. So the next example is a magazine show slash web series. This is a bit more intensive and requires more time and resources. For us at SJC, when we got into video content, creating a web series was always the goal. We created Inside SJC Athletics, a bi-weekly magazine show similar to those that you see on Yes Network or MSG in New York. It's a segmented show with interviews with student-athletes or staff, student-athlete competition segments, rewind or on this day segments, and practice check-ins, which were a way for us to feature action during the pandemic. Web series and vlogs on YouTube are extremely popular with younger generations. These types of videos are compelling and fun and can also be shared to Instagram via IGTV and Twitter via YouTube integration. IGTV is an Instagram feature that allows creators to post and archive long-form videos as a collection or web series. I highly recommend IGTV, using it for types of videos like this. They're easily organizable in Instagram as well, and people can access them in the past very easily. Overall, this project was huge for us during the pandemic when content was hard to come by. These videos were engaging and popular with student athletes, alumni, and parents in particular. And this is just an example of one. Again, this is a long video, but I'm just going to bounce around a little bit. This has an interview in it, a practice check-in, and a little kind of competition we did between two men's volleyball players.
Hi everyone, my name is Alexandria Hart. I am a senior, I'm a nursing major, and I play for the women's lacrosse team and run for the cross country team, and I'm also the SAC president. I chose SJC just because it showed me such a sense of family when I was here touring the campus, talking to the coaches, and I just really like the small class sizes and just the relationships I can have with the teachers, my classmates, and all the athletes. It really just showed me a sense of pride and family.
So that was, it's a bunch of questions for the interview, and we take a break halfway through the interview, and we drop some other segments in there. This was, like I said, another little competition thing, fun little thing between two volleyball players.
I'm Jack Solon.
I'm Mike Bosco, and this is the Dizzy Layout. We're gonna spin around with the bat, and first one to make a hoop wins.
Let's go.
Yeah. All right, ready? Set. Go.
So this was like a round of three we did with them. Just a fun little thing, couple of games, basically. The other thing we include in these videos is the practice check-in. And like I mentioned earlier, during the pandemic, because we didn't have any sports during the pandemic. And but some of our teams, well, most of our teams were practicing. So it was kind of a way for us to still feature our student athletes and kind of give them as much exposure as we could. And it was just kind of good for parents to see their kids playing. So this was an example. It's like just a short minute, I think it was, basically. Just a good little piece for that. And then just back to the interview with that.
There's definitely a lot of rewards that come with it. Like I said before,
this was a particularly long one. I think it was like 11 minutes or whatever. Yeah. Some of these can be as short as like 8, depending on the content, depending on how much time you have and all that. So this was kind of our baby, like when we started, like this was the thing we wanted to do like during the pandemic to just kind of get something out there, something a little different. And honestly, to like keep us busy so we don't like go crazy during the pandemic. But it turned out to be good. And I'll come back to it later, but hopefully we can keep it up during like a regular season. So. And this is just the last thing I'm going to include. This is our banquet video. So with the pandemic, our last two banquets, if you call them that really, were virtual. Instead of doing them live, we created pre-recorded segments and played the video live in a Zoom meeting. I'm sure many of you did something similar to this as well, but I thought it was worth mentioning that using video editing software, you could optimize control over virtual events by pre-producing them. I'm going to show you a little bit, but I highly recommend this if you can convince your superiors, if you're doing a virtual event, if you can record everything before and then just hit play and Zoom. It might be more work for you in prep, but I'm a control freak and I kind of freak out when I have to do something live. So I like all the control I can get. And this was it's kind of a good way to do that. So I'm just going to bounce around. There's a lot of different segments. This is like a half an hour video. I'm just going to show you a little bit of what we did. We got creative during COVID. So this is it.
Golden Eagles, we miss you. Welcome to our virtual athletic celebration.
We hope that everyone is staying safe and upbeat during these challenging times.
Well, we wish we could be together for the Goldies.
This is just like an intro video. And then, so to get creative, I mean, we had a highlight video. But we had to get creative, obviously, during COVID because our AD didn't want to give out awards because half of our teams didn't finish their seasons. So this became basically like a celebration instead of a banquet, really. So we did kind of segments. One of these segments was about student athletes that were essential workers. So we kind of got their testimonies. From
in the grocery store,
it's a cool way for us to feature student athletes who are very much active during the pandemic and doing really good work.
During the pandemic, obviously there have been a lot of challenges, mostly dealing with all of the changes and adjustments to social distancing and the cleaning.
I got a job in early April at Handy Pantry in Wisconsin. Some challenges that I've faced.
So that was one of our segments. What else are we doing here? We had a TikTok competition. So we each team made a TikTok and we had the kids vote on it.
Yeah, you can be the greatest. You can be the best. You can be the King Kong banging on your chest.
So that was a cool little fun way to get them interactive. Every time we do a banquet, we do like something kids can vote on. They produce something ahead of time, whether it's like a meme. We did a meme competition one year. This time it was TikTok. Then the other kind of big thing we did was like a quarantine day in the life type of video. We picked 4 student athletes, 2 male, 2 female, just to kind of give us a sense of what they were doing during quarantine. It was, again, a fun little way for them to kind of engage their colleagues and just kind of show us what they've been up to, because, you know, it wasn't easy for everybody, obviously. And we wanted to, again, feature our student athletes in any way possible.
Don't sleep in. But as athletes, since we're not getting a healthy breakfast in, we need to make sure, regardless, that we're doing one thing. And that thing is exercise.
What's up, everyone? This is Mike Bosco from the men's volleyball team. On the nice days every morning, I try to start my day off with going outside, getting a little physical activity, because there's not that much to do during quarantine, trying to make the best of it. Right now, I'm on my two-wheeled Ferrari. Yeah, this baby's purring right now.
During quarantine, I've been trying to stay fit, staying healthy.
And we had just our senior videos, what we do every year. We get the senior graduating class for each team, and we kind of ask some questions, kind of reflecting on their time at SJC. And we usually do it in person. We get everyone together and record it, but we did it over Zoom instead.
Rita.
Ruchi.
Kyle.
I missed the party. There's a prompt with like a question, like which your teammates is most likely to survive on a desert island or something like that. Or they're asked to like do an impression of their coach and whatnot. So it's kind of there's a lot in here. So I just want to kind of show you guys like some of the kind of things you could do pre-recorded. These are also things we do regularly. This isn't just like a COVID thing. But it's just other types of content. And for me and for us in the department, like the real thing is like you just kind of show a more human side, and you give kids a camera and they just kind of shine. And I think at the end of the day, that's what we do. So I'm just going to wrap up quickly with just how to get started. So again, based on needs and resources, this is what we do at SJC, and the response has been really good. We also value staying up on industry trends, and this is the direction we see our field moving toward. For some, this may be a lot of new info. You'll need some new equipment to get started, but not too much. You need a camera, obviously. If you don't have a great camcorder and can't afford an HD one, don't be afraid to use your phone, your iPhone, or your Android device. They have good enough cameras. They do. People shoot movies on iPhones, so don't be afraid to use it. You definitely will need editing software. There are many options for different price points and skill levels. Apple iMovie is the easiest to use and is free on Apple computers. Adobe Premiere Pro is probably industry standard, but requires an Adobe license. I would recommend the free program DaVinci Resolve because it is free, intuitive, and can be tailored to different skill sets and layouts. Basically, in DaVinci, you can set up the entire layout of the program to mimic that of Premiere Pro, Final Cut Pro, if you've used those in the past. I really can't suggest it enough. It's a really good program and it's free. It's good stuff. And finally, you need a plan. Settle on your goals and produce content to reach those goals. Here's just a couple of tips just to wrap. Work within your means. Like I said earlier, we're all not Ohio State, and that's fine. Work with what you have and make your content your own. Don't be afraid to experiment. You could try a specific type of content and ditch it the next day if it doesn't pan out or appears to be too much work. Don't be afraid to try new things. It's going to take time. You won't be a whiz in Premiere Pro or iMovie overnight. Watch YouTube tutorials on your program of choice and get accustomed to all the features and options. And the biggest piece of advice I can give is this. Aim for consistency. Projects you take on in the summer will not be as easy to complete in the spring. Make sure you're not biting off more than you can chew. And finally, don't be afraid to talk to other SIDs. Ask for help and bounce ideas off your colleagues. I'm sure you guys do this already, but it's been a big help for me in my career. And we're all friends here, right? So that's all I got. Back to you, Dennis.
Thanks, Andrew. Appreciate it very much. There's a lot of good information out there. And what we can try and put the proposals up on the web, and the video of this panel will also go up there. So you'll have a chance to research it there if you miss something. And now we'll go to the writing aspect, and that'll come from Andrea James.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Let me get started. All right, everyone can hear me all okay? So we'll get started here. I'm Andrea James, like Dennis said, Associate Director at Carnegie Mellon University, and I'll be speaking about some writing tips for some sports. Mostly this is individual-based sports, but that participate in team settings. What I've done is kind of categorized it all into something for all to start. This can obviously work for more than just these individual sports, but every sport that you cover. I think we should try to make things relatable. Talk to your coaches, ask them for quotes. If you can get to know your coaches and what they have as a timeline for their post-match protocol and what you need to get done, then you'll both be able to understand your timetables and be able to set together everything that you need. And I know this seems like it could be more difficult as the season progresses. I know I'm 16 years into the same university with a pretty veteran staff. We usually kick things off early and get things done. And then as the season goes on, whether it's some losses come to play or holiday breaks, and it doesn't always continue out through the year, but it's something we try to work on. One of the things you can do is to set the precedence at photo day by letting your student athletes know that you're going to look to email them about their thoughts. You can start that off by having just a good general post-competition questions that you can just email easily. And then if there's anything to add competition specific on that day, you could add that in. And once you've sent the email to the student athletes, you could have let your coach know so that they can also communicate to that athlete to pay attention for that email, and you can get a response quickly. If you happen to be on site, away or home, and you can have the chance to do a quick interview, try to do that. But we also know that having the time to transcribe an actual interview is difficult to come by, especially if you're preparing for a second game of a doubleheader, or having to break down equipment, and obviously you're sending the stats to your colleague, that it's probably just going to be easier if you can copy and paste off of an email or text message as well. And of course, if you can establish that good relationship, then you should be able to get something within 30 to 60 minutes of that competition ending. That could be a pretty generous time frame. You might be following along a soccer game from the road, and so 20 minutes after the game's done, you're finished because you've had the bulk of your story done. But if you know that you are going to be able to get those responses from those students or the coaches, that's something you can hold off on publishing right away. Maybe you can work on your graphic while you're waiting for them to respond, but they should be able to get you something before they leave the locker room, or even as they're getting on the bus and for their trip home. And then, of course, we all know that losses are a lot harder to write about and harder to get your coaches to respond to. But if you can have your coach understand and help them understand that their thoughts on the competition, win loss or not, will enhance your recap and potentially spin that loss into something positive for fans and recruits. Next, I want to talk about some style options. Swimming and diving, track and field, sequential order, it can be something you can look at if you're following along, or if the close meet or the last couple of events really determine the winner. That could also make for a lengthy recap though. So you could also just look to use those specific points in your first or second paragraph. You can group events together. You could group by athlete. When I'm taking my notes down, I typically start by writing out the top three finishes of a meet and then decide which way I want to go group together. And then, if we've dominated a meet, look to just stick in just the victories, and if we swept an event. Track and field, similar to swimming and diving, I write out each of the top finishes and then look to see who I can remove at the end, because we know that the long stories don't really get read all the way. And so we can remember that the results in your box score are also giving that same information. Don't feel like you need to include every person's name. Find a best time and then decide who can stay in the story and who can get cut out. For cross country, you could write based off of your top five finishers, possibly use your sixth or seventh runners if their finishes prove to be major point separators, or look to just do your top three finishers and find some extra information. If it's a conference meet, how did those repeat athletes do the last time they competed at that against the same similar competition? Tennis. Order of finish, pretty important. I know some coaches will give that information, other coaches forget about it. Talk to your coaches, ask them to include it when they're sending you your files. And then with, I know with the new XML output, when you put those up, it doesn't actually show the order of finish like the HTML does. So that's just another writing point you can put in. If it's a 9-0 victory, pick a couple people to write about doubles pair. One doubles pair doesn't have to be your number ones. And then of course, whoever maybe finished the first two singles matches because of they secured that match win. If it's a 9-0 loss, look for some individuals that the matches that were most closely contested, and then try to use some names maybe that you weren't able to use in a previous recap. Volleyball, similar to softball and baseball doubleheaders, look to combine one story if it's been a multiple match day. You could also look for leaders and just write about a specific person if the stats pan out that way. Or if it's one match, look to use your play-by-play more and do like a paragraph per set. So the next few slides I have are just individual points that you could look for these sports. With swimming and diving, I think that preparation is key. If you can ask your coaches to include the cut times or the pool or school records, meet records and such in the results, it's pretty easy for you to find. If they're unable to do that, you can have those sheets, whether a document that you can easily access on your computer or a statistics tab on your website, so you can find those things under a history tab even. The NCAA cut times are typically updated in late August or early September and can be found on www.nca.org. I like to try to compile a list as the season progresses so that I can talk about how often our athletes have won certain events, or even if it's the fifth or sixth time that they've won that event. If it's a season opening meet, you could always research what happened the previous year for the returners and have something for comparison's sake. Ask your coaches for the season top times. You could also look, if you keep track in your bios, career bests and stuff as well. And have a conversation with your coach to know how times might fluctuate during the season, be based off of training methods for the larger meets. You might not have season bests to be able to write about in a certain after a certain meet. Track and field is very similar to swimming and diving with that. Preparation is key, like I mentioned. Again, it's the same stuff, including stadium or meet records. Be ready to look them up. You can use the track and field results reporting system to look to see who are your top event marks and also regional and national rankings. You know, compile that list of finishes, just like with swimming and diving. Ask coaches about those. Your season top times. And I know for track and field for us, we haven't done that weekly. That's usually a season thing, but at the end of the year, but our coach also touches base with us at the end of a meet and lets us know what PRs are for some of the students, because it might be someone who's finished, you know, 13th, 14th, 15th in the event, but it might be their PR. So it's just a one way to get someone that you haven't written about in the past into a story. Cross country, I think it's one of those sports that often gets our least attention. The meets happen, you know, either they're usually in the morning right before football is happening for the day, or you might have a home, you know, doubleheader soccer or some volleyball games going on. And so when the results come in, it's not the first thing you're thinking about, but they definitely need and deserve the same attention that we get to the other sports. So if you could look to the coaches' rankings to establish the competition level that's at the event. If a lot of the races have mixed divisions, and so you could state who's participating. Fans might not know that a university that you're competing against isn't in your division. If you're running the same race as you've run the previous year, you could look to compare the results for those athletes that raced in that. You could also look at your meets during the year, if they're consistently running 6Ks or 5Ks for the women. And then I think the men almost always run 8Ks. And then talk to your coach, ask what the weather's like, set the scene, get the course description. Tennis. Tennis can be some long days, especially if you've been out and had to sit down through like multiple dual matches. But their recaps are typically shorter. And so One of the things I looked to do this year was really look to see what our season records were individually for each of our winners and try to find someone to write about. Early on, we had a lot of 9-0 wins. And so the box scores tell you what their individual match scores were. But if you can find some other information about how those athletes have done throughout the year or even through their career to add something in, it just is details that parents and fans wouldn't know to look for. And if it's a season opening match or just the same competition that you've had and the same opponent from previous years, you can look to see if your athlete has competed against that same opponent before. Looking for milestones for those career records I mentioned, and also just any streaks that might happen for your team or individuals. Golf, also longer days on the course, but shorter recaps. Now, most of the tournaments are using live scoring, and so that gives you the opportunity to really look at the scorecard and see how the athletes have done. You can include their numbers of pars and birdies and eagles, all the great shots, figure out like what holes they had those finishes on and add that in. You could also use, if the tournament isn't using live scoring, you can talk to your coaches to hopefully maybe they can get pictures of the scorecards. The players can take pictures of their scorecards and then give it to the coaches to be able to give to you so that you can collect that data yourself as well. And then if you don't already have a records book, you could look to put one together. That way you have lowest rounds and top three finishes, number of victories, so you can compare to some past performances as well. The last two sports I have to talk about are volleyball and soccer. So with volleyball, I think we all know it's a pretty exciting game to watch, but sometimes it can be hard to recap in an interesting way. You could look to use play-by-play for point streaks now, since most of the games are being done in live scoring. You have that play-by-play to use. And you could also look for the number of kills and assists, aces, et cetera, that a certain player has per set. And then using your XML sheets to filter by category and like game-by-game logs to compare to see if it's the best hitting percentage of the season or how many times someone has had double digit kills or digs or high assist numbers and such. And for soccer, close with them, you know, keep an open mind. If you don't know something about the game, you know, ask your coaches. If it's a home game, try to take some notes of important plays such as the breakaways or big saves. And then if it's a road game, you could look for those same similar things in your play-by-play. You won't have the description, but you'll have the player names and the timestamps that can help you put out some more information. Similar to a lot of the other sports, look for streaks, winning streaks, home streaks, away streaks, how many times has a certain player scored in a game. And what I like is if soccer's new to you or it's just not your favorite sport to cover, you know, get to know your coach and ask them about terminology and how and when you can use it. The sports I covered here were based off of the sports that we have at Carnegie Mellon. I don't have a lot of those other individual sports like maybe rowing, squash, racquetball, and such, wrestling. So if there's any questions at the end, there might be a couple, another panelist or just any of our colleagues here that could give you some tips on what to write about for those sports. Accomplished. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrea. And now we're going to talk about finding the bodies to help you get it done. Nate Smith.
Absolutely. Hi, everybody. Hope everybody's having a good summer so far. It's not going too fast for everyone. So I will share my screen. And let's play from the start. All right. So again, as Dennis mentioned, my name is Nathaniel Smith. I work at Alfred University. I'm the Athletic Communications Director. Been there for almost 2 years, so it's about 20 months now. So a lot of these are things that I've learned not only in the last 20 months, but you know, over my time in the last 7 years of, you know, kind of working in various roles in athletic communications departments. So we'll begin. So before you can handle the rough days and the long days and stuff like that, you got to assemble your crew, and the right crew is super important, as the Fast and the Furious franchise has so eloquently shown us over the years. So a couple of things to look for is, you know, looking at majors in your school. If your school offers a great communications program or a media program, look to that for help. If you don't, you got to get a little creative. So one of the things that I like doing is talking to student athletes and, you know, kind of seeing, you know, kind of the strengths that they have. They are often some of the more reliable people to deal with because, you know, they understand the idea of like scheduling stuff. And then they're usually there to support other teams as well. Also talk to coaches all the time. Hey, is there somebody that you like that could be a great worker for us? And that's helped as well. Local alumni, friends of the program. Those are people that are alumni that kind of want to be involved in some way. They could be former student athletes, recent graduate alums, and we kind of utilize that a lot during this pandemic season. Kids that have finished playing, they're not going to play anymore, that went to grad school or hung around. And that was very successful for us this year. And depending on location, looking at other schools for interns. So in my case, we're lucky to have a SUNY school right across the street, Alfred State, that has a sports management program. So every year around the spring semester, we've utilized their interns, and they've been big helps for us as well, kind of filling in the gaps. And though obviously this differs based on, you know, the type of school you have. If you're a one man or woman shop, we have multiple assistants and stuff like that. But these are kind of some of the things that I look for in terms of finding help. And another thing, if you're like me and you're afraid to be in classrooms and talk to students for 10 minutes before class, you know, utilize flyers on campus, social media posts to ask for help, and you'd be surprised. That's where they are. So try to hit them where they are. So as far as student workers, this is more specific for them. I look for two things now, and that's a positive attitude and a hard worker. I feel like you could teach your student workers a lot of things. You can teach them whatever you need to teach them to get them to prepare them for the work that they're about to do. But those two things are kind of key to dealing with the stressful days. Is if you have somebody that is positive, that even if things are going wrong, they're with you and they'll stick with you, and somebody that's willing to work hard and do the work. So those are kind of the things that I look for. Everything else can be taught. All right, so utilizing your assistants. So this is what we do for a typical week. I use Google Spreadsheet. You don't have to use it. You could use a similar program to utilize weekly work schedules. So right there on the bottom, kind of lay out what the tasks are and on the day of the week. This was from our last week of work in the spring, you know, after playing 19 sports at once. And I have their numbers just in case we need to call them for an emergency or things of that nature. So I usually send a group text message. You can use Slack if your school allows that, allows you to pay for it. And then I just send them a weekly message every week, like, hey, you know, here are the assignments. They're up on this spreadsheet. Have at it, first come, first serve. And usually by the end of Monday, I usually get a good amount. And there are days that where it's a little bit slow, weeks a little bit slow. We'll get to that a little bit later, but kind of push them as much as possible to kind of fill in those sheets as early in the week as possible. So if anybody needs a sheet, you know, just let me know, send me a message. I could send you this over to look at as well. All right. So one thing I'm starting to like, and something I noticed in previous stops and I want to kind of utilize here, is using, again, local alumni, friends of the program to work PA or play-by-play. I think this is super important because you need that consistent voice for not only fans in the stands, but fans on your broadcast on the computer to like listen to you. They like a consistent voice, makes things easy, makes things familiar for them, and it'll keep them tuned in instead of jumping around. Some schools have great communication, again, media programs where they have student-run radio stations and stuff like that, and student-run video stations. That's okay to use. But I like having somebody that's a little bit older, a little bit more seasoned, that understands the sport and that's a little bit more reliable in that sense to work PA or play-by-play. And if those people aren't available, usually myself or my assistant usually will run that show. So again, it's all about utilizing what you have and the tools in your toolbox. All right, so now to stat or not to stat, I'm leaning towards personally utilizing student workers a little bit more to stat contests. I have a few sports that I love statting personally. I love statting basketball, hockey traditionally, and softball, baseball. But I think there are a lot of opportunities for students to, one, teach them. And I think it helps you, it opens you up to kind of supervise that work area just in case things go wrong, and they likely will go wrong. So when things are wrong, you know, instead of being on that computer and having to stop what you're doing and switch things up, you can kind of jump in and make the correct changes that you need to make. Also, I'm starting to do this with a couple of sports, having students train others with like my supervision late in the season. Usually we'll have an extra slot, maybe at the end of a volleyball season, for somebody to just come and shadow and just to learn if they're gonna be there the following year. So I think that's something that could definitely help, and kind of having student workers trying to train others to kind of, again, we're just trying to take the pressure off ourselves on a day-to-day basis, especially on game day. So the non-game day duties kind of in between the show, you know, kind of scheduling office hours to help with program creations and, you know, kind of photo editing, which is the one thing I hate doing personally. But it's super important to get those photos up there. So I usually have office hours for a couple of assistants to kind of come in and get that work done. Again, it's all about kind of working with the talents of your assistants. It's like any coach would say, you know, you just want to put them in a position to succeed and trust that they'll do the job for you. I know trust is a little bit hard to kind of to gain, but my thing is I tell them, hey, you know, I want to put you here because I think you can do it and I believe in you, and just kind of pushing them to believe in themselves a little bit more kind of helps you when those days are a little bit tough and you have people that can come through for you. Also, I love getting people in kind of unfamiliar situations every once in a while, just so they could teach them something new. They'll be surprised what they can learn if, you know, they just kind of actually do it. We had a student who hated public speaking, but had a great voice. So kind of trained them a little bit to do PA. And in this past year, with everything happening and the limits that were placed on us in terms of whom we could hire, we had her doing PA for a lot of our sports. And I think it turned out well, and she was amazing. So it's just, again, believing them and trusting that they can do the job will always help. All right, so managing stress. So one of the things that you'll learn is you will have student workers or workers that are your favorites. Try not to burn them out early in the year. Burnouts are only cool in cars, not with people. So try to limit the hours that they work early in the season. Mix in some other people, men or women in there early, just to teach them and kind of save them for the end if possible, if you have veterans, people that have been here for a year or two. All right, so what happens when a student cancels on you last minute? Always good to have a plan B. And this is one of the reasons why I like kind of letting students stat, because if they cancel, I could always jump in and help out in a pinch. So it's always good to let them know, like, hey, it's okay you cancel, things happen, life is weird, thing, you know, things come up, but just alert you beforehand. Just like, hey, let me know beforehand. Don't be afraid to tell me before you know, because most of the time I think students already know that or day or so in advance that they won't be able to work, but they're just trying to, either they're too afraid to speak up or they just don't want to disappoint you or whatever. That's okay. Just let me know and we'll be able to help and find a plan B or C or D. In an emergency, look to other staff for help. There have been situations, especially this year, where I needed just like a body, and usually it came from an assistant coach from another team. I know a lot of small schools, they'll have teams that are assigned to certain games. So sometimes I've had to ask a volleyball coach, for example, for a softball game, hey, I may need, there might be a potential that somebody's not signing up. We're kind of low on signups. Do you have somebody else on your team that could help out? You know, in addition to the two or three people that are ball people or working the scoreboard and stuff like that. So it's always good to, again, utilize what you have and don't be afraid to ask people for help. Okay, and another thing, it's April 15th. If you're in the Northeast, that means you've probably had one or two nice days. You probably haven't yet, but it's the first 50 plus degree day on campus and kids start to check out, or it's a fun day or some type of event on campus. We have here at Alfred, we have hot dog day. So that's usually a day where we see the lowest amount of people there. So they'll likely check out. What do you do? Kind of offer them additional perks. I can't tell you what the perks are, but that's up to you and kind of what you can, you know, agree with your athletic director or whomever's in charge. Treat them whenever possible, especially during doubleheaders. I know with COVID, it was kind of hard to like do pizza, like bring in pizza for the crew and everything like that. So, you know, at the end of the year, we did a little kind of social distance pizza party with everybody. And that was a cool way to just like, hey, you know, thank you for everything. In the past, my lovely wife has made gifts for workers that were there for the whole year. It's kind of another way of just like letting them know, like, hey, we appreciate you and thank you for all the hard work that you've done. And then finally, how to manage your own stress. Crossover season is tough. It can break you in a lot of ways, but I'm learning to make a point to take a complete day off. And what I mean by a complete day off is staying far away from work as possible, not touching your phone, not answering emails, and have it, if you have an assistant, you know, have that assistant be your conduit only in an emergency situation. And then just communicating with the coaches that, hey, a day off is truly a day off for me. And just don't waver from that. There was a situation with myself where, you know, taking a day off, and I've had coaches, that's the perfect time that a coach calls you about a video that needs to be done this second or something that needs to be done this second. Try not to waver, because they wouldn't want to be bothered when they had a day off as well. So trying to keep that same energy back and forth. And I think if you do that, it kind of helps you as you go into crossover season, getting those couple days off here and there. And then try to do it within crossover season as well. I know it's a little bit hard, especially with things going on and multiple sports happening at the same time, but try to find some time midweek or some time, or maybe like a couple half days in a row where you're just coming in and just, again, have that expectation that your day off means that you will not be bothered. And I think that will help with a lot of the burnout that seems to happen a lot with us over the past few years. All right, and I'll end it with a great quote from the great Dominic Toretto. The most important thing in life will always be the people in this room right here, right now. I don't tell my students that, but I just kind of let them know in knowing certain ways that, you know, we're a family. I'll be here for you as long as you need it. And like, if you need anything, you know, don't ever hesitate to ask, and I'll be able to help you. We're in this together, we're a team. So, you know, try to work within those confines, and I think everything will work itself out. Dennis, on to you.
Thank you, Nate. Nice job from everybody. Really appreciate it. There's a lot of good information out there. We are running up against a deadline from the next panel. So if you do have questions, I haven't seen any in the chat room, but if you do have questions afterwards, please contact the SIDs at their individual schools. Andrew is at St. Joseph's College on Long Island. Andrea is at Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh, and Nate is at Alfred University. Coming up at 11:30 is the panel on diversity, equity, and inclusion, hosted by Allie Paquette of Middlebury College, and then followed at 12:30 by the Service Awards Luncheon with Chuck Sadowski displaying a video he put together recognizing milestones by our members. And then there are two sessions in the afternoon and the virtual awards ceremony at 7 o'clock tonight. Thank you for attending the panel. I hope you got something good out of it. And we will see you in a few minutes in the diversity room. Thank you.